comes from Psalm 100. Make a joyful noise to the Lord, all the earth. Serve the Lord with gladness. Come into his presence with singing. Know that the Lord, he is God. It is he who made us, and we are his. We are his people, and the sheep of his pasture. Enter his gates with thanksgiving, and his courts with praise. Give thanks to him, and bless his name. For the Lord is good. His steadfast love endures forever, and his faithfulness to all generations. Please let us pray. Dear Heavenly Father, we thank you, Father, for your blessing upon us. And we thank you, Father, for your presence in our life each day. And we thank you, Lord, for all the many blessings that you have graciously granted for us each and every day. You are the God who grants forth blessing to your people. And you have given to us a life here in the body of Christ where we are able to praise you and thank you for all that your hand provided. To enter your courts here in thanksgiving to you. We praise you, Lord, this day, for you are a benevolent God, and you are a God who is gracious to us. We thank you that you grant for us this life within your kingdom, where we are able to be with one another and love one another and worship you. We pray, Lord, for your blessing upon our worship of you today, as we give praise unto a God who so richly blesses us and who is devoted to us, who loves his children. We make this prayer to you, Father, in the name of your Son. In Jesus Christ we pray. Amen. Please let us now continue our worship by confessing our faith through the Apostles' Creed. I believe in God, Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and buried. He descended into hell. On the third day, he rose again from the dead. He ascended into heaven and sits at the right hand of God, the Father Almighty. Thence he shall come to judge the quick and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Universal Church, the communion of saints, forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, the life everlasting. Amen. Please be seated. Now's the time during our worship where we make our confession of sin. Please let us quietly confess our sins to the Lord together.
Thank you. Amen. Good morning, everyone. I hope that all of you are doing great this morning, that you've had a blessed week, and you are ready for God's word to you today. Just so you know what to expect for the next few months, Pastor Adam and I will be preaching through 1 Thessalonians. Pastor Adam has graciously asked me to preach with him, alongside with him, but it will be mostly Pastor Adam. And so we will be in this book most of the time through about May. And then we will also be having a few guest speakers and preachers here over the next few months. So that's what you can expect. Today's message comes from the letter of 1 Thessalonians chapter 2 and chapter 3. And so if you'll turn with me to 1 Thessalonians, we can read God's word here together. Thessalonians is all the T's are together in the New Testament. This is the word of God. But since we were torn away from you, brothers, for a short time, in person, not in heart, we endeavored the more eagerly and with great desire to see you face to face, because we wanted to come to you. I, Paul, and again, but Satan hindered us. For what is our hope or joy or crown of boasting before our Lord Jesus at his coming? Is it not you? For you are our glory and joy. Therefore, when we could bear it no longer, we were willing to be left behind at Athens alone. And we sent Timothy, our brother, and God's co-worker in the gospel of Christ, to establish and exhort you in your faith, that no one be moved by these afflictions. For you yourselves know that we are destined for this. For when we were with you, we kept telling you beforehand that we were to suffer affliction, just as it has come to pass. And just as you know, for this reason, when I could bear it no longer, I sent to learn about your faith for fear that somehow the tempter had tempted you and our labor would be in vain. But now that Timothy has come to us from you and has brought us the good news of your faith and love and reported that you always remember us kindly and long to see us as we long to see you. For this reason, brothers, in all our distress and affliction, we have been comforted about you through your faith. For now we live if we are standing fast in the Lord. Please let us pray. Dear Heavenly Father, we thank you, Father, for your blessing upon us, and we thank you, Father, for your love and faithfulness to us each day. You are the God who invites us here to our church to worship you, and who invites us here that we together give you praise and honor you and hear from your word which you have given to us. And this letter to the Thessalonians, it was by your will and design that we have this letter. We have this word that we may learn from it, learn about what was happening when this letter was written and why it was written. We pray, Father, that you will open up our minds today, our hearts and minds, to hear your message today. And we pray, Lord, that despite the inabilities of this man who gives it, that this message will still go out and accomplish all the purposes which you have set for it. We pray, Father, for your blessing upon this message, in spite of the messenger who gives it. For it is in the name of your Son, Jesus Christ, that we pray. Amen. So I wanted to start us off this morning and just talk a little bit about how Paul ended up in this place called Thessalonica. Just what happened there and why he wrote this letter to the church that he helped to form there. Paul was on his second missionary journey. He was away from his home church in Antioch, and this was the first time that he was in Greece and the first time that he was in the continent of Europe. Paul was with Timothy and Silas, and they had just crossed the Aegean Sea, and they were in Greece. And the first city that they went to in Greece was the city of Philippi. As Pastor Adam has already taught us a little bit, Paul and Timothy and Silas, they had a very hard time in Philippi. Though they were immediately able to preach the gospel, and some people believed right away, Paul and Silas were thrown into prison. But though they were imprisoned, they were ultimately able to leave prison because Paul was a Roman citizen. And in the short time they were in Philippi, they were able to, or God enabled them, so that they were able to form the first church that we know of in Greece. From Philippi, Paul and Timothy and Silas, they went to a couple of other towns. And after going to the other towns, that's when they ended up in Thessalonica. Now, when they were in Thessalonica, Paul did what he normally did when he went to a new city or town to preach in. And what he did was he went to the synagogue where the Jews were worshiping, And also where these people called the God-fearers, the Gentiles, who worshiped with the Jews, where they were worshiping as well. And he preached to them. Paul preached to the Jews and Gentiles that Jesus Christ had come, that he was the Messiah who the people were expecting, and that he died on the cross for our sins. And in Thessalonica, Paul was very blessed with his evangelizing and his preaching, just as he was in the city of Philippi. The Lord granted that the people believed the message through the preaching of Paul. And in Thessalonica, not only did some of the Jews believe in the message, but also many of the Gentiles, the Greeks, who were worshiping with the Jews. But just like Paul, Timothy, and Silas had a very hard time in Philippi, they also had some difficulty in Thessalonica. Though some who heard the gospel believed, there were some Jews who did not believe. As God's word says in Acts 17, but the Jews were jealous, and taking some wicked men of the rabble, they formed a mob, set the city in an uproar, and attacked the house of Jason, seeking to bring them out to the crowd. So just as Paul and Silas were persecuted in Philippi, they were experiencing a similar kind of persecution in the city of Thessalonica. Some of the Jews did not believe the message, and they wanted to find Paul, Silas, and Timothy. So they went to a house of this man named Jason, who was a new believer. They wanted to bring Paul and Silas out to the crowd, where only God knows what would have happened to them. But the people who believed, this newly formed church, this infant church in Thessalonica, they were able to somehow hide Paul and Silas. And sometime after that, they were able to save Paul and send them to a neighboring town called Berea. Now, when they were in Berea, they went into the synagogue again, and they preached to the Berean Jews. And again, the people believed. Some of the Jews believed, and some of the Greeks who were worshiping with them, they also believed right away. But when the Jews from Thessalonica heard that Paul was preaching God's word in Berea also, they actually came over to Berea, and they began to do the same thing that they did in Thessalonica. They drew up a crowd. They stirred up this crowd against Paul and Silas and Timothy. And that's when the new believers in Berea, they sent them to Athens. And it was during this time when Paul began thinking about the Thessalonians and the persecution that they had to have been experiencing as well. Since the Jews were in Thessalonica, the Jews from Thessalonica had come over to Berea, Paul needed to know what was happening to this very young church that he helped to plant in Thessalonica. And so Paul sent Timothy to visit this infant church, and he did so because he wanted to show his commitment to them. He wanted to show them that he didn't just come to Thessalonica to preach them the gospel. Paul wanted to show the new church that they were essentially important to him, and also that he was committed to them, and that as a church, we need to be committed to one another. And so that's why Paul sent Timothy from Athens to this newly formed church. This sermon and this passage today is about the importance in our Christian life for us to be committed to one another, to be devoted to one another, because we are all part of one body. And if we look into our passage today, as we look at the example of Paul and Timothy, we see three ways for us to be committed to one another, devoted to one another in our fellowship in Jesus Christ together. The first of our ways is for us to ensure that each of us is turned towards Jesus and Jesus alone. The second of our ways today is for us to encourage one another to persevere through any persecution in our lives. And the last of our ways today is for us to comfort and encourage one another through the witness of God's work in our lives. So let's start with the first of these, to ensure that each of us is turned towards Jesus and Jesus alone. For this first point, let's look back at our passage at verses 17 to 20. But since we were torn away from you, brothers, for a short time, in person, not in heart, we endeavored the more eagerly and with great desire to see you face to face, because we wanted to come to you, I, Paul, again and again. But Satan hindered us. For what is our hope or joy or crown of boasting before our Lord Jesus at his coming? Is it not you? For you are our glory and our joy. Now, one of the blessings that I hope for all of you, and this is something I pray for from time to time, is that you all be married, that you marry someone who is in Jesus Christ, and you have a family together, that you have a Christian family together. But when you decide to be married, you need to remember that this person not only needs to be Christian, he or she needs to be Christian, but that you also need to be able to be committed to this person for the rest of your life, until death do us part. And so it can't just be any person. It's someone that you know you can be devoted to for the rest of your life. And this person also needs to be someone who can commit to you for the rest of his or her life. And that's what God wants for us, generally speaking. I mean, of course, there are people who don't get married. But that is what God's will is for his church, that we be a people who are first committed to one another in marriage. And then also in all the many different relationships that we have with one another. Parents are to be committed to their children, of course, in Christ. And children are to be committed to their parents. But we're talking about our friendships as well, and the other relationships that we have in Christ. Work relationships, teacher-student relationships. The Lord wills that we are committed to one another in all these that we have in Christ together. In our passage today from chapter 2, we see an example of a very specific relationship that Paul has with the church in Thessalonica. Paul was, of course, this missionary, great missionary, and the church in Thessalonica was just this very young church that he had preached the gospel to, and they had just come to faith in Jesus Christ. And what they were before Paul came to them, we learn if we look a little bit earlier in this letter. God's word says in chapter 1, For they themselves report concerning us the kind of reception we had among you. And this is the important part. How you turned to God from idols to serve the living and true God. This newly formed church in Thessalonica was both Jewish and Gentile. And God's word teaches us today that they were idol worshipers, and how you turned to God from idols to serve the living and true God. The Jews were Pharisees who essentially worshiped the law and not God. And the Gentiles were also those people who worshiped along with the Jews, the God-fearers. But you have to presume that there were some of them who worshiped the pantheon of gods, the Greek gods. They were at least in part believers in the Greek gods, which, as the scriptures say here now, are idols. And so this church, which had previously not received the grace of God, through God's work by sending Paul to them, they had received the gospel and turned from these other religions and turned towards the living and true God, who is Jesus Christ. As I was saying before, Paul was very worried about this newly formed church that had just turned to Jesus and was now being persecuted by the Jews. And what he wanted to know is if they had given into the persecution, if they had given into the persecution and they had turned back to the worship of the synagogue and the worship of idols, to the old religions. And that's why Paul sent Timothy to them. Paul sent Timothy because he wanted to be sure that the Thessalonians were not doing this and that they were still turned towards Jesus and Jesus alone. Now, in the same way that Paul was committed to this infant church and sent Timothy to them, we as a church need to be committed to one another in the faith, but in all the various relationships which we have with one another, parent and child, teacher, student, and just our friendships with one another. And depending on the situation, we need to ensure that each of us is turned towards Jesus. Paul's concern was that the Thessalonians were turning back to their idols, to their old religions. And so what we as a church need to do is ensure that the people that we have a relationship within our church and also outside of our church, that they are not turned towards error, towards what is false, but that they are turned towards the true God, who is Jesus. And so the question really is, are they living a repentant life? Or are we living a repentant life? Are we living a life that is turned towards and devoted to Jesus? In Christ, we have a responsibility to one another. We have a responsibility to keep each other accountable in Jesus, and that each of us is leading a repentant life, a truly faithful life, and that we are not turned towards the world and turned towards sin. And what that requires of us is that at some times we will have to gently admonish one another. We will have to gently give a push in the right direction. We will have to encourage one another to walk more faithfully before God. And the reason why is that the Lord wills that his church be holy and that his church be pure and it not be like the sinful world that is out there. Therefore, we have to be devoted to one another, and in doing so, be committed to God himself and his will and his purposes for the church. So we as a body, through all the relationships that we have with each other, we can encourage one another not to be sinful and not to be like this world that we live in, but to be turned towards Jesus and to be of Christ. So that's our first point today, that one way for us to be committed to one another is for us to encourage each other to be turned towards Jesus and Jesus alone. Another way for us to be committed to one another in the faith is for us to encourage one another to endure or persevere through persecution. After the Last Supper, on that night, Jesus taught the disciples, and he gave to them some of the last words he would ever say to them. And these words are recorded for us in the book of John. We don't find these words in any of the other gospels except the book of John. In these last words that Jesus taught the disciples, we learn that being Christian and being of the faith is not always going to be easy. Not everyone is going to love you. The world is not always going to love you. And we as Christians, we will even be persecuted for our faith. As Jesus said to the disciples, "Remember the word that I said to you. A servant is not greater than his master. If they persecuted me, they will also persecute you." God's word here from the book of John teaches us that part of being Christian is being persecuted by the world. If they persecuted me, they will persecute you also. And so persecution, because of this world that we live in, because it is sinful, is just part of the Christian life. As God's word says also in Timothy, "Indeed, all who desire to live a godly life in Christ Jesus will be persecuted." When Paul sent Timothy back to this new church in Thessalonica, as God's word says here, he wanted this newly birthed, newly formed church not to be moved by any of these afflictions. That's from verse 4. And what that means is Paul didn't want the Thessalonians to be agitated, disturbed, troubled, worried about anything that was happening to them because of the persecution by the Jews. When the world persecutes you, and God's word says that it will, the idea is that God will allow it. And he will allow it for several reasons, which we find in the scriptures. As God's word says in 1 Peter, God will bring trials in your life. And the reason why is so that the tested genuineness of your faith, more precious than gold, that perishes though it is tested by fire, may be found to result in praise and honor and glory at the revelation of Jesus Christ. The world persecutes you, evil persecutes you, and God will allow it. And you in turn turn towards Jesus who receives you, and he gives to you a stronger and tested faith. He sanctifies you. Another reason why he allows persecution is so that he will be able to reveal himself to you. He'll be able to reveal his work in your life and help you to overcome whatever is happening to you in his life, in your life. Now, Paul didn't want this newly formed church in Thessalonica to be moved or agitated or disturbed by the persecution of the Jews. He didn't want them to be troubled or worried. But what he wanted from them is for them to understand that they had comfort and peace in Jesus, that they could turn all the more to Jesus during these times of difficulty. In the case of the Thessalonians, the Lord allowed this newly birthed church to be afflicted by the Jews, and for another reason, that they would be a witness to the neighboring towns and cities. As God's word says earlier in this letter, they received the word of God and accepted it through much affliction, and they became an example for all the believers in Greece. So God's purpose in allowing the Thessalonians to be persecuted by the Jews was for them to overcome that persecution, to still have that faith in Jesus and be a witness of God's salvation to all the new Christians in Macedonia, in all of Greece. And what Paul was doing by sending Timothy to them was encouraging them to persevere, because he knew that with the Lord, there's always a purpose. There is always a reason. And so he sent Timothy to encourage them to continue in the faith, finding their comfort and their peace with Jesus. In the same way that Paul sent Timothy to help the Thessalonians to endure through the difficulty that the Jews were causing them, we can also encourage one another. We can encourage one another and remind one another that what God wants is that we turn towards him all the more during those times when we are enduring persecution or trial in our life. And that may be as simple as just reminding someone that the Lord wants you to pray to him, and he wants to help you through whatever is happening in your life. Jesus is a faithful God, and he will help you through any difficulty that you have in your life. Or maybe as simple as just saying to them that you are praying for them. Now, you may be saying to yourself now, Pastor Sang, I don't really know what you're talking about, this whole second part. I've never been persecuted in my life for my faith, and is this really going to happen to me? And that's a valid question. We live in the United States, which is a Christian country, and there is just much less visible persecution than in other countries, where the government is persecuting Christians, or the people in power are. But it doesn't have to be the government that is persecuting you for your faith in Jesus. As Pastor Adam said before, it can be the people in your life. It can be your friends who don't share your faith and who despise the fact that you believe in Jesus, that Jesus died on the cross for our sins and that we are going to heaven. And people will hate you for believing that you believe that you know all these things, which you know to be the truth. And they may treat you badly because of that. And that will be persecution if and when they do. Persecution is hatred of Christians, and it is acting upon that hatred, and it will oftentimes just be verbal in nature. The world will speak against your faith. It will speak against Jesus. Though we live in this world, we as a church are able to encourage one another through any difficulty that we have in this world and in this life together. And this is another way for us to be committed to one another in the faith. So that's our second point today. Then another way for us to be committed to one another in Jesus is for us to encourage each other through any persecution by the world. Our third and last point today is for us to bring comfort to one another through the work of God in our lives. And for this last point, let's go back to the passage. Now that Timothy has come to us and has brought us the good news of your faith and love and reported that you always remember us kindly and long to see us as we long to see you. For this reason, brothers, in all our distress and affliction, we have been comforted about you through your faith. For now we live, if you are standing fast in the Lord. One of the greatest blessings of the Christian life is when we are able to see someone else that we know experience God's blessing. Just be blessed by God, or see God's work in their life. And in this past year, we at our church have been so blessed by God, but also by, I believe, the youth at our church and by the college students and just God working through all of them. The praise team, for instance. The praise team has been so wonderful these past 1.5 years. And it's wonderful to be witness to God working through them and then them just being blessed by God and what God is doing through them. I mean, you are leading us in the worship of God, in the worship of Jesus, and you are doing that from a very young age. And when the college students, and you know who you are, when you decide to serve at the winter retreat, I'm just letting you know that that was very encouraging for everyone involved, for all the students, and also for the teachers especially. And so this is just one of the great blessings of our Christian life together, when we are able to witness God's blessing to all our brothers and all our sisters in Christ. When Timothy reunited with Paul in Corinth, Paul was able to experience the same kind of blessing when Timothy reported to him about the Thessalonians and the faith that they had. They still had faith in Jesus, even despite everything that was happening to them and that had happened to them. And as Timothy brought good news of this faith, Paul himself was comforted, and he was just encouraged by this news that Timothy had given to him. And this news came at a time when Paul needed to be refreshed, when he needed something from God to help him, to encourage him. As one writer says, Paul was dispirited. He was without consolation. And he was like a dead man, carrying around with him the dying of the Lord Jesus. But when Timothy had given him good news of the faith of the Thessalonians, it was like he had come back from the dead, like he had been given new life from God. And God will do this. The Lord will do this. He will at times just know that we need encouragement, that we need something from him to help us to keep going. And what he will do is he will give that encouragement by letting us see and be witness to his work, not just in our lives, but also in someone else's life. Paul was able to see that this faith that the Thessalonians had in Jesus was a real faith. And when Paul learned of this through Timothy, God was able to comfort him and to encourage him to keep enduring his own persecutions. He was still being persecuted, and also to keep serving him. In the same way that the Thessalonians were a blessing and an encouragement to the Apostle Paul, we also can be an encouragement to one another here at our church. Children, for example, those in the youth group right now, can be a real encouragement to your teachers and to your parents at our church. Anytime that we see any of you enjoying the fellowship and just loving one another and enjoying our time together, it is an encouragement to your parents and teachers and pastors to see. Anytime that we see you serving here at the church on the praise team, for instance, or even teaching the younger children, which some of the college students have been doing, that is also a great encouragement to your parents, to your teachers and elders. And I believe for those of us who are older, we can encourage and comfort one another by being a witness of God's work, his blessings to us in our lives. It is always encouraging to hear how God is working in other people's lives. And that is part of what we need to do here together as a church, to encourage one another, and in doing so, refresh one another through God's work in our life together. Now, this sermon today has mostly been about how we are committed to one another in Christ. So this sermon has mostly been about our relationships with each other and how we have need to be committed to one another in our faith together in Jesus. And so we need to ensure that each of us is turned towards Jesus and Jesus alone and not towards this world that we live in. And we need to encourage one another through any persecution or trial that we may be suffering. We need to be there for each other. And lastly, we need to be a witness of God's work and bring comfort and encourage one another in all the various different relationships that we have with each other in Christ. And when we are committed to one another in these ways, what we are doing is we are showing our commitment to the Lord, to Jesus himself. So since we are of the body of Christ and we are united in this faith together in Jesus, let us be committed to one another in the faith. Let us do all these things, encouraging one another through trial and difficulty, ensuring that we are walking in the faith together, and let us refresh one another through God's work in our lives. And let us do all these things. Let us be committed to one another, because the Lord Jesus Christ is committed to us. He is devoted to us, and because he loves us. Please let us pray. Dear Lord God in heaven, we thank you, Lord, for your blessing upon us. And we thank you, Lord, for your presence in our life each day. You are the God who is committed to us, who has always been committed to us, and who has always loved us, your children, and who always will. We thank you, Lord, also for our church that you have granted for us here that we are able to be a family together, devoted to one another. We pray, Lord, that you will help us to continue in our commitment to each other, ensuring that we are all walking in the faith. We are encouraging one another through difficulty, through persecution. We are comforting one another through the witness of God's work in our lives. You are a faithful God, a God devoted to us, who loves your people, and a God who is deserving of our praise and our worship of you. We give you praise this day. We honor you. We pray, Lord, that you will help us to be a body who loves one another, who is committed to one another in you. We make this prayer to you, Lord, in your name. In Jesus Christ we pray. Amen. Let us now, this time, sing our last song of praise in response to the preaching of this message from God's Word. Please let us stand. Let us offer up this next song of praise.
that is committed in love to you, and committed in love for one another. You have called us to this life in the body of Christ. We pray, Lord, that you will, by your Spirit, work in our hearts. May you help us to keep our commitments to God, and may you help us keep our commitments to one another. May they reflect the love that you have given to us, that you have for us. We make this prayer to you, Lord, in your name, in Jesus Christ we pray. Amen. Please be seated as we have just a few announcements for the church today. First announcement is that there will be fellowship lunch after Bible studies today and after the second KM worship. So please come down for fellowship lunch to fellowship hall. Second announcement is that the church is offering folk painting to anyone who's interested every Saturday from 10 a.m. to 12 a.m. So if you're interested in folk painting, please speak with Deacon S.G.'s son. With that, please let us conclude our worship this morning with the Lord's Prayer. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread. Forgive us our debts, as we also have forgiven our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For yours is the kingdom, the power, and the glory forever. Amen. So let's finish our worship today with a doxology.
I'm going to go to the hospital. Oh, not there. Oh, come on. Watch me.
Ah, 지금 뮤트 해놨어요?
아, 네.
어, 거기 저기 오타가 해가지고 저기 어, 어쩌는데 사람이 저기 많아가지고 이쪽에 안 들어가.
어,
내가 안경을 보면 이렇게 바꾸면 잘 안 보여. 뭔가 원래 거긴 내가 아침 원래 오후에 가는데 아까 소리 들어서 아침에 꽃도 안 치는데 원래 아침 가서 지금 원래 나 거기 시티인데 거기만 가서 왔어. 근데 거기 어떻게 뭐 막아놨더라고. 못 한다고 뭐 담배 피우고 안 해. 그래가지고 막아놨다고 그러고 갔는데 이쪽으로 보니까 큰 오빠들이 있다. 약간 내가 이제 들어가서 같이 가란 말을 해가지고 잘 나오더라고.
주님 인물대 나오신 우리 성도님들 환영합니다. 함께 기도하시고 우리 찬양 드릴 수 있습니다. 좋으신 하나님, 한 주간의 삶도 주님 주관하여 주시고 주님의 귀한 은혜로 저희들 발걸음을 주의 전으로 인도하시니 감사를 드립니다. 주님 오늘도 주님께서 저희들 허락하신 귀한 은혜를 기대하며 예배드립니다. 주님 이 시간 우리와 함께 하심으로 영광 받아주시고 우리에게 하나님의 은혜 시간, 축복의 시간, 말씀의 시간 되게 하옵소서. 감사를 드리고 예수님의 이름으로 기도드리옵나이다. 아멘. 우리 함께 힘차게 우리 죄를 정케 하신 주님의 피밖에 없습니다. 고백하며 지금 주님께서 저희를 부르시고 주님께서 이 시간 오셔서 우리의 마음과 영혼을 만족하시고 채워주시는 은혜를 바라보며 나왔습니다. 이 시간 간절히 기도하는 마음으로 온 나의 자비로운 주여 채워주소서. 우리 함께 감사히 생각하시면서 찬양하기로 합니다.
성삼위 하나님, 우리의 모든 예배를 받아 주시옵고 이 시간 우리를 친히 다스려 주시옵소서. 이 모든 말씀 우리 주 예수 그리스도의 이름으로 기원하옵나이다. 아멘.
열방은 기쁘고 즐겁게 노래할지니
주님의 은혜를 공급하여
하나님이여 민족들로 주를 찬송케 하소서. 땅이 그 소산을 내었도다. 하나님이 우리에게 복을 주시리니 땅의 모든 뜻이 하나님을 경외하리로다. 사도신경 오른손 들과 함께 신앙 고백합니다. 전능하사 천지를 만드신 하나님 아버지를 내가 믿사오며 그 외아들 우리 주 예수 그리스도를 믿사오니 이는 성령으로 잉태하사 동정녀 마리아에게 나시고 본디오 빌라도에게 고난을 받으사 십자가에 못 박혀 죽으시고 장사한 지 사흘 만에 죽은 자 가운데서 다시 살아나시며 하늘에 오르사 전능하신 하나님 우편에 앉아 계시다가 저리로서 산자와 죽은 자를 심판하러 오시리라. 성령을 믿사오며 거룩한 공예와 성도가 서로 교통하는 것과 죄를 사하여 주시는 것과 몸이 다시 사는 것과 영원히 산 것을 믿사옵나이다. 같이 앉으셔서
사랑과 은혜가 풍성하신 하나님 아버지, 축복과 사랑을 감사합니다. 날마다 저희와 함께 하시며 이 험난한 세상길이 실족지 않도록 은혜 가운데 살 수 있도록 도우셔서 오늘도 이와 같이 복된 주님의 날에 가장 귀한 예배의 자리에 저희를 불러 모아주셔서 마음과 정성을 다하여 예배드리게 하시니 감사합니다. 예배드릴 때 아버지 홀로 영광 받아 주시옵소서. 또한 저희들 마음이 다급하여 갈급한 심령으로 모였사오니 우리에게도 은혜를 베푸셔서 충만한 은혜의 시간이 되게 하여 주시옵소서. 죄로 말미암아 죽을 수밖에 없는 저희들을 주님의 크신 은총과 사랑으로 구원하여 주시고 하나님의 백성으로 삼아주셔서 새 생명을 주시고 새로운 삶을 살 수 있도록 인도하여 주신 은혜에 감사드립니다. 지난 한 주간도 저희들 세상의 많은 풍파 가운데 늘 지켜주시고 은혜와 감사함으로 살게 하여 주신 은혜에 감사합니다. 은밀히 죄의 모든 것을 보시고 계시는 하나님 아버지가 계심을 잠시 망각하고 사랑의 눈만을 의식하더라 참된 가치를 보고 계시는 하나님을 망각해온 죄를 용서하여 주시옵소서. 저희들 오직 하나님을 의지하는 신실한 심령으로 하나님의 의만 나타내는 삶이 될 수 있도록 인도하여 주시옵소서. 저희들의 삶이 예배되기를 원합니다. 감사와 찬양의 제사되기를 원합니다. 생활의 모든 부분에서 하나님이 함께 하신 것을 알게 하시고 주님이 명하신 대로 주님이 증인이 될 수 있는 능력을 더하여 주셨어서 특별히 이 시간 귀하신 김종국 선교사님을 보내주셔서 저희들의 심령과 영혼의 양식을 말씀으로 채우셔서 마음으로 하나님을 사랑하고 힘을 다하여 주를 섬기는 복된 시간이 되게 하여 주시옵소서. 사탄의 종자였던 저희들을 구하시고 주님의 백성으로 삼아주시고 성도를 불러 모아주셔서 이 터전에 주님의 몸된 교회를 세울 수 있도록 인도하신 주님, 긴 시간 동안 교회를 이끌어주시고 주님의 사명을 잘 감당할 수 있도록 인도하여 주신 데 또한 감사드립니다. 주님께서 주시니 당신의 영으로서 세우신 교회의 요리 교회의 계로 말미암아 노아 시대의 고대 방주 역할을 잘 감당할 수 있도록 이끌어주셔서 비진리와 이단이 만연한 이 때에 영원한 생명이신 주님의 말씀하니 빛과 생명의 길을 발견하고 깨달은 신은 저희에게 하여 주시옵소서. 말씀의 감옥으로 타들어간 이 시대에 생명의 담비 역할하는 저희